to the MMA Roadshow, episode number 96 and a half. We're here in Phoenix. We're actually in Las Vegas. I was going to say Phoenix,
which is typically stupid. Typically where the half shows.
Well, no,
but
I was
you
gonna
weren't
say
even
Phoenix.
In Phoenix.
I wasn't even in Phoenix. All right, we should probably start there. I should say I was going to say Denver, but the problem was I was going to say Phoenix because I flew through Phoenix.
Oh.
Because I'm such an American Airlines mileage whore.
That
instead of taking the Southwest Airlines direct flight from Vegas to Denver, I actually went Vegas to Phoenix, Phoenix to Denver, and on the way home, Denver to Phoenix, Phoenix to Vegas. And mm-hmm. I guess it felt familiar from 2 weeks ago when we were in Phoenix,
actually. We're Phoenix.
So, yes, let me start that again. Welcome to the MMA Roadshow, episode number 96 and a half. We are here in Las Vegas.
That's true. Well, speaking of mileage, I love it when I see your tweets, when I'll see something. I was like, oh, Morgan checks you or something, or your thing popped up. Like, so when the roadshow, when somebody tweets it, right. It pops up
oh,
my thing.
I totally screwed
so
up.
So when you
I
tweeted
totally
to, like, American Air, I was like, we're never going to get fucking sponsored by American Air. Because, like, whenever you're so used to getting, one, your upgrades, you're so whatever, this, that when anything's off time, you fucking start chirping. You're like, American Air. Oh, you say we're on time, we're leaving this. Why are people walking the wrong direction? You send a little picture of people coming off or whatever, which – but in all fairness,
hey,
though
– Pam kind of
came out. Pam came out.
Pam came out.
But in all fairness, that is totally what they're doing. They're padding their numbers. Mm-hmm. You know, they want to be on time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for them to go on there and have it say it's on time that they're leaving. I mean, who's going to go back and actually fact-check it and change it? Nobody does it. You know, nobody's doing it.
I took a picture that literally said we're supposed to be boarding right now. People were – and I sent it from the wrong account. I apologize. I pulled an Ali Abdelaziz, and I had the wrong account pulled up on my Twitter. I sent it from my Nurmagomedov's account.
Yes.
That was my fault.
I was a little surprised. I was like, oh, he sent it from the Roadshow account. Okay.
I don't know what happened. I think our pocket changed accounts or whatever. Yeah. And, so that's what happened.
Well, believe me, I've accidentally – I think just once when I tweeted something from the junkie account instead of mine, I was like, oh, fuck.
Oh, see, I don't have the junkie account on my phone.
On your phone? Yeah. See, because I did it because I think I was if I want to pin tweets and things like that, and if mm-hmm. I want to check the numbers, I put it on the phone. So I was like, oh, okay, I'll do it. And then, it's only hit me once. The Facebook's got me more times because I have Facebook account, and, like, if I don't watch it, it'll have me logged in as the junkie. So, like, when I try to chime in on one of the chats somewhere, it was like, MMA Junkie says, oh, yeah, look at that fucker, or whatever. I'm like, oh, shit. No, that's not what MMA Junkie says.
So, by the way, that does happen. People have multiple social media accounts, and it does happen from time to time.
It does.
All right, listen, so I should say, we're a little bit late posting the and a half the way we normally do because I thought it would be good. I mean, I was by myself in Phoenix. Well, I should say by – I wasn't – God damn, I just said Phoenix again. I wasn't by myself in Phoenix. I was by myself in Denver.
Phoenix?
And I wasn't even by myself in Denver. I had the Magnificent One, Steven Morocco, there, but he was staying at a different place. We had Justin Park there, but he was staying at a different place. And so I was kind of by myself. And rather than just doing another solo episode, I figured, you know what, let me get back to Las Vegas. Let me grab cold coffee. Let's do this. And I thought that would be the right way to do it.
See, the great thing, you never even thought about just not doing one.
Hell no. You got it.
Because I was like, you know, bro, I'm not there with you. You know, it's all good. We don't have to do it. You know, we can just whatever.
You see who cares about you people. You know? John Morgan cares about you. Cold Coffee doesn't care about you. He's like,
I'm trying to save you all the pain. You know, I figure one time is enough.
Well, listen. First of all, I just want to say this really quickly. Everybody that wished me well wishes for my son, his recovery, his health, I just have to throw this out. That meant so much to me because I threw a little message at the end of the last episode about how kind of my son that was dealing with influenza. I mean, the flu, right? I mean, it's just the flu. Who hasn't had the flu? We should all not even worry about that. But, man, it just impacted the hell out of me. I'm not going to lie. To see my little kid on FaceTime having no energy and telling me how bad his body hurt everywhere, man, It killed me. I, if you don't have a kid, I know it's tough to understand, but it killed me. And I just mentioned it briefly at the end of the last episode. And every single person that chimed in, I got so many messages on Twitter and Facebook and text messages and WhatsApp and everything else. And, like, I can't even tell you how much that means to me, man. That meant so much. And I have a good update. He's feeling good. The medicine that he got prescribed to that day that we recorded the last episode is doing wonders, and he's feeling a lot better, and everything is good. So I don't know. I just want to throw that out there because I can't tell you, man. I mean, sometimes me and you, cold coffee, we're sitting in a hotel room halfway around the world drinking some frosty beverages, talking to these microphones, and then – who the hell knows if anybody's listening or not? You know what I mean? And then somebody, when somebody hits you up and they're like, bro, I hope everything's good with your kid. Man, I just can't tell you. It meant the effing world to me, dude.
No, it's are they going to be able to get back in the country?
Well, we'll talk about that later. Right. Let's save that for later. All right. Listen, we got two places to start. We can start with UFC on Fox 23, or we can start with Conor McGregor's Q&A in Manchester. And I'm not really even going to let you make a decision. I'm going to make the decision. You know where we're going to start? We're going to start with Conor McGregor. And you know why? Let me tell you something, Cold Coffee. This is ridiculous. If we have questions about how big of a star that Conor McGregor is in sport, let me tell you about this. Conor McGregor posted an Instagram the other day. Did you see this by chance? Did you see this?
I don't actually... I'm probably one of the few people, I guarantee probably everyone that listens to the show probably follows him on Instagram. I don't actually follow him on Instagram.
All right.
I think I have him on Twitter.
Well, I don't even really use Instagram that much. I will say this. The young Mike Bond is fantastic at following Instagram. Let me tell you what he posted. All right. This was right before his Q&A in Manchester. And he posted this. I'm so made. Heading to do a Q&A in front of 5,000 fans. You read that, right? That's more than UFC attendance tonight. And it's on pay-per-view. F the UFC, F Floyd, F boxing, F the WWE, F Hollywood, and F you too. Pay me.
Yeah.
All right, so strong. Now, let me just say this. Of course, we have to put a post up about this. And there was a time in my life that I thought, you know what, we're MMA junkie. We're above this. We don't need to put a post about somebody's social media post. But you know what I started to realize? People click on this stuff, and they like it, and they want to read about it. Like you just said. You're an MMA fan, and you don't follow Conor on Instagram, right? So we put this story up on MMA Junkie.
To preface that, I don't follow a lot of fighters.
Oh, no. And
Ring Car Girls, maybe? I'm more visual, so I'll follow the big boobs and the ring car girls and random chicks. Jenny's been stepping up her game.
Dude,
but when it comes to fighters,
vote for her. Vote for her. World MMA Awards.
Oh,
vote
man,
for
but
her.
They got my girl Carly Baker too. But man, Jenny done stepped it up though. Right. I know. But no. That being said, it's nothing about me and Conor per se, but. I just don't follow a lot of the fighters.
I'm trying to step up my social media game too. Actually, I'm trying to figure out a way to better organize it. Cause listen, man, I'm almost 40 years old. I'm not a big social media guy, but I need to figure out a way to step up my social media game. But let me say this: Cold Coffee, we put this up on MMA Junkie, right? Just a post about that Instagram post. That's all we did, right? It did. I don't ever talk about hard stats. You know, I can't say hard data. You know, we get in trouble. If we talk about hard data on MMA Junkie, if we give actual numbers, we get in trouble.
But we How about limp data? Can we give...
Oh, we can give limp...
We can give some limp data.
I see what you did there.
Took you a second.
Damn it. I came to record this thing like 3 hours ago, and you've been plying me with frosty beverages ever... I just said frosty beverages, I think. I didn't even think I said frosty beverages. Anyway, here's what happened. The post for that did more... than our play-by-play, which the play-by-play that we do on MMA Junkie is always one of the most more trafficked pages on the entire site. Now, I will say, it was a Fox event. It always goes up for pay-per-views because obviously pay-per-views, some people don't want to pay the $60, so they'd rather just, you know, kind of refresh on MMA Junkie or whatever, see what the results are. But, dude, can you imagine anybody? Think about it. There was a UFC. Now, what Conor said was wrong when he said, oh, I have 5,000. That's more than at the UFC. That was a straight lie. But whatever. He's just talking trash. But imagine that, Cold Coffee. A post, his Instagram post. Us, and I'm not even talking about his Instagram post. I'm talking about us writing about his Instagram post did more traffic on MMA Junkie than the play-by-play.
Yeah.
For UFC on Fox 23.
But I think what I think you probably get a lot of people because I would almost want to just click on it just the fact that if you guys maybe had any insight as to what was said. Mm. So you can have people that want to go that because, you know, me, unlike maybe some of the few listeners that we have, thank you very much. I love you all three of you.
Both of you.
Both of you. That I love both of you. I didn't buy the pay-per-view. I'm not going to buy the pay-per-view. I bet there's a lot of people in the States that didn't do it either. You know, maybe there are some that are just so diehard that maybe they did. Maybe he'll release the numbers. Maybe he'll actually show the numbers, you know, prove whatever numbers he actually says. You know, so I would probably click on the thing hoping that you guys maybe had some insight because I get some people okay. Some people are probably going to give you grief. Why didn't you guys buy it? Aren't you supposed to report up on it? You know, yada, yada, yada. That'll probably be the next step.
We did buy it.
Did you? Who did?
Mike Bond did.
Well, of course he did. did he
Do we have plenty of stuff? Do we even go to MMA Junkie?
No, not if my day off.
Jesus Christ.
What? But that's what I'm thinking. People are going to the store because they want to hear what was said in
okay,
it.
Okay, all right.
That's my point. Is
oh,
that like,
I see what you're saying.
Like,
okay.
It's not just the fact that, oh, hey, it's, excuse me, Connor. They're like, what the fuck happened in this pay-per-view?
Okay, that's fair.
You know, so I can see because I'm not going to buy it. I mean, if I wasn't, what, I mean.
Well, all right, so here's what's funny. So that whole pay-per-view situation, it happened in Manchester. You do know that we have Abby Subban over there, over in England.
Subban?
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 Subban.
Subban.
Subban. It's Subban. So we tried to send him over there, and we weren't sure if there was media. In fact, we were originally told there was no media allowed. We did later find out that media was allowed. But that said, so there apparently what we were told is there was no filming allowed. So you could have media there, but you could only do audio recordings because it sounded like if you even took a picture or tried to like do like a quick video clip on your phone, you were kicked out. So we didn't have anybody there, but as we do, I mean, MMA, when I say we, what I should say is MMA Junkie didn't have any official media there, but what I should say is that we, as MMA Roadshow, fortunately were able to sneak in an audio recorder, and, you know, there was some stuff that did appear on the pay-per-view. A lot of stuff, you know, was broadcast to the world if you paid your $5. But if you didn't pay your $5, you know, you couldn't get the behind-the-scenes stuff. And that was
That's supposed to be five bucks?
Yeah, it was just $5. But it was supposed to be private. But luckily, the MMA Roadshow was able to sneak in a little recorder, and Conor McGregor just had this to say about his particular current situation in the UFC.
I'm thinking I'm going to go on the Roadshow next week. True story. That's what he said. Fuck the UFC. Fuck you.
Pretty sure that was Joanne Calderwood. but anyway. All right. Yeah.
Yeah, that's Joanne meets Conor McGregor.
All right. So listen.
So $5 is not that bad.
$5 is not that bad.
That's not that bad.
Errol Hawani was doing the Q&A.
Now that's a little bad. Like, I mean, no. So, are they pre-done questions?
No.
I'm sure he declared, or he just
made
like
it clear,
he just
no. Went, he made it clear he could ask whatever he wanted. He made it clear he could ask whatever he wanted.
That's, but
he
did
made
he
it,
really?
No, he made it clear on Twitter he could ask whatever he wanted.
Sure. Did he get paid to do it?
He made it clear that he could ask whatever he wanted.
Did Eric
All right,
get
so
paid to
Dana
do it?
White, by the way, so here's the whole thing about this. What came out of this to me was the fact that Conor McGregor and Floyd Mayweather, which just seemed like the stupidest possible fight in the world, to me, I think it's going to happen. And
I don't think it's that stupid. Makes a lot of
well,
sense.
Well, all right, we'll get into that in just a second. Here's what I will say. While all that was going on, I was all right, JoJo, you're fine. We don't need to hear any more from you. While all that was happening, I was actually at UFC on Fox 23 in Denver. Mark, you're on the line? Did you have something to chime in? Are you allowed to chime in right now with the lawsuit? I mean, there's pending litigation.
Yeah, we'll see.
Sorry.
That's terrible.
All right, that was... we'll just edit that last part out. All right.
Yeah, we don't edit that out.
I was just joking. We never. All right. So listen, while that was happening, we were at USC on Fox 23. But here's what's interesting.
Well, you were.
Well, I was. Dana White stopped by the post-fight press conference at UFC on Fox 23, which was pretty interesting. And you
so
know,
did he do that on his own, or did Lene make him?
Nope. He did it on his own. In fact, I'll
so
tell you what happened.
He's itching for it. He's itching to be out in front again.
I'll tell you what happened. I was told that the top three winners would be at the post-fight press conference. And even once I sat down, I was told the top three winners would be at the UFC on Fox 23 post-fight press conference. 30 seconds before Dana White walked into the door, I was told, guess what? We're going to have Dana White as well.
Who's that?
Who's Dana White? He's the UFC president.
And who gave the heads up?
Nobby. PR rep Nobby.
I bet he must have called an audible. Did you see like the last UFC event when they had the tent at T-Mobile? He came out there and was watching.
Mm-hmm.
He was itching.
Snuck in.
I think he was itching for it. Like, I've never seen Dana come watch a fucking presser, but I think as the questions kept going on, I think it ran a little bit longer, and I think he balked, and he's like, fuck it, I'm out. I'm over it. Let's go. But, like, I saw something. I was like, why would Dana show up unless he was, like, oh, gauging the situation and maybe wanted to go up there? So maybe we're going to see some more of that. Maybe the fact that, you know, for a while there, he was doing it so much, he pulled back. They're like, this is the best decision. And now they haven't tapped him.
Yep.
I think he's itching for it a little bit. I think he wants to get out there. So.
Well, I got some thoughts on that. So before we get there, let's hear this, because I had to bring up, with all the stuff that Conor was saying about Conor and Floyd Mayweather, I had to bring up the question. You know I had to bring up the question. So the Magnificent One was there as well. Stephen Morocco was there. So listen
to
us.
Yeah, y'all was double teaming him a little bit.
Listen to how we did it. Listen to how we did it, because – I came in there. I tried to be smooth. You know what I mean? I try to come in. I try to softball him up a little bit. I try to get him comfortable answering questions, and then I try to get the quote that I need, right? And then the microphone gets handed over to the Magnificent Morocco, and he just comes in with the hammer.
So you softballed it. He took the bat and just shoved it straight in, huh?
Whoa. I don't know. I'm not sure about
– Who's got the first question?
You're cut off. All right, let's listen to –
Can't cut me off at my own house.
Good point. All right, let's listen to the MMA Junkie crew and their handling of Dana White in the discussion of Conor and Floyd.
Very nice. And last question I have for you. Can't let you get away without asking about Conor McGregor. He was, counter-programming you this evening with his Q&A over there. Some of the comments he made, I don't know if you had a chance to see, but on Instagram, he put a pretty strong post that included F the UFC in there. He said that, you know, his next fight is going to be in a boxing ring, and he'll do it with you or without you. Would love you to be on board. Just curious what you think of his comments.
I didn't hear all that. Hey, listen, when you're about to go on, and do a pay-per-view that you're charging people $5 to listen to you talk, I'm sure you got to say some pretty crazy shit. All right. You know how I feel about Conor. You know, I've always shown Conor nothing but respect. And if he wants to go down that road with us, let me tell you, it'll be an epic fall.
As a follow-up, do you anticipate it going there?
I don't know. It's not up to me.
Has there been any advancement or any additional talks from your initial $25 million offer on that fight between Mayweather and Conor?
No.
Not a word?
No.
Do you think it'll happen?
I think here's what I think the chances are. About the same as me being the backup quarterback for Brady on Sunday.
You seemed a little bit more, I don't know, you did make an offer, though.
Yeah.
And previously you
Because he was full of shit, and he said that he had made an offer, which wasn't true. Mm-hmm. So I made a real offer. That was a real offer.
Mm-hmm. They were saying there's a chance.
Oh, yeah. I'll be suiting up on Sunday.
All right. Strong comments from Dana White. Not completely disrespectful, not completely pushing everything away, but obviously that strong, strong comment of it could be an epic fall if Conor McGregor wants to dig in against the UFC. And I think that's fair. Now, here's what gets more interesting. So while this is going on, we're in Denver, Colorado. Back in Las Vegas, there's a boxing match happening between Leo Santa Cruz and Carl Frampton. Now, this was at the MGM – I think it was at the MGM Grand Garden Arena. I hope I'm getting that right. But Floyd Mayweather showed up to this fight. And here's what's incredibly interesting about this, Cole Coffey. this was not a Floyd Mayweather promotion. He wasn't promoting this event. So it's not like he needed to be there. It's not like there was, you know, he had a vested business interest in being there. No. He just happened to show up right before the main event, right while the Irish fans were singing Sweet Caroline for Carl Frampton. Well, not necessarily for Carl Frampton. That sounds kind of weird. But they were just, you know, singing as they needed to do in the background because they are these amazing Irish fans. And Floyd Mayweather had some very interesting comments to say. And if you haven't heard him, I think you have to hear this.
49-0 may in fact become 50-0 because Conor McGregor has said this afternoon in a question and answer period in England that his UFC career is on hold indefinitely. He will now turn all of his attention to fight only one man, and that is Floyd Money Mayweather. Is this fight going to happen? He says he's determined. And now it's up to you guys to come together.
I believe the fight can happen. Conor McGregor, like I said before, he's a tough competitor. He proved throughout the years in the UFC that he can fight standing up. So we'll just have to see, you know, what the future holds.
He says you're not the A side, you're the scared side. Your response to that?
Well, we'll just see. We know I'm the A side. Of course, you know, it shows throughout the years, so many record-breaking numbers that we have done, me and my team. So we'll just see what, you know, what the future holds. Hopefully we can make the fight happen.
Will you meet and get together with him? He said he will fly here to Las Vegas, and he would like to meet, much like you did with Manny Pacquiao, to try and figure this out.
Well, you know, that comes down to Leonard Ellerbe, Steven Espinoza.
Oh, that comes down to will Floyd Mayweather pick up the phone or meet him in person like you did Manny?
Can we make this fight happen? Absolutely. That's what everyone wants to see. And, of course, Showtime is the biggest and the best in the business. So, hopefully, Showtime pay-per-view, we can make it happen.
And the weight would be what? He's fought anywhere from 145 to 170.
Probably either 147 or 150.
Final thought on this for the moment. In your heart of hearts, and you know, you always knew you were going to fight Manny Pacquiao.
Yes.
Do you believe in your heart of hearts that you will fight Conor McGregor? Overcome all the obstacles.
I don't know. I truly believe the fans want this fight. The fans have been asking for this fight. It's all about entertainment. He's very entertaining. He's very outspoken like myself. So let's give the fans what they want to see.
So there it is, Cold Coffee. Floyd Mayweather, that weighing in was his thoughts as well. And listen, we're going to get the UFC on Fox 23, but this was so big. Let's wrap it up. I still believe this fight's going to happen. I didn't. When we first started talking about, I mean, Cold Coffee, we've been talking about this fight for a while, right? And I feel like every time we've talked about this fight possibly happening, we've kind of been like, I'm embarrassed to talk about this. I'm sorry we're even bringing this up. Because this, dude, if you're listening to this, you're a hardcore. You're a hardcore. Or you're my mom. One of the two.
She's hardcore, too.
She's hardcore. She actually just texted me earlier, and she was like, I need to get a hold of a bookie. I went 3-1 on the main card the other night.
She's funny.
But listen, I'm telling
you. She's obsessed with it now.
She's getting obsessed. Listen, the things that they're saying, there's just too much damn money on the line. There's too much money on the line, and I still think it's a stupid fight. Cold Coffee, I still think it's a ridiculous fight. Now, Floyd Mayweather came out and said he thinks he could do it at like 147, 150, somewhere around there. So that makes sense. I mean, I'm not sure that, you know, Conor wants to go down to 145 anymore, but I bet he could get to 147 or 150. But
for that kind of money, I guarantee he'd get down to 145.
That's it. But
no problem.
And listen to the comments we just heard from Dana White. Listen to what we, you know, saw reported from Conor McGregor. We couldn't actually record it other than your sneaky audio that you snuck in there,
yeah,
which
was
fantastic.
That sent that.
Amazing. By the way, we'll check is in the mail. I mean, I don't know. What do you
think? Refund you the $5 you paid for them to get in there.
What do you think? I mean, are you getting the same feeling that I'm feeling that, like, as stupid as this fight is, and when I say it's stupid, let me just clarify, and I've said it before, but the reason I say it's stupid is that because, listen, if this was an MMA fight, Conor would kick Floyd's ass. No question about it.
Sure.
Floyd, but the whole thing is Floyd would never fight in an MMA fight because he understands that. In a boxing match, God bless Conor McGregor's abilities, but the best boxers in the world haven't been able to touch Floyd Mayweather. There's a reason he's 49-0.
Yep.
I think it's a whitewash one way or the other. But I'll tell you what, I'd pay $60, $70. I guess they're probably going to make us pay $100 for it.
Mm.
I'd pay it. No. I'd pay it, right? Don't you want to?
Oh no, I want to watch it.
Oh, not you. You steal.
I'll fucking steal the shit out of that on the internet somewhere. But no, I mean, I think it's a, you know, I'm intrigued by it. You know, and you know, the biggest, you know, nobody has anything when it comes to like MMA. There's no issue there. There's no issue there. And typically with the boxing, there wouldn't be an issue either. But I just, you know, the way that Floyd's been talking, man, if he takes Conor lightly. And Conor catches him with a cup. And that thing is, like, nobody catches Conor. I mean, nobody catches Floyd.
Right.
You know, Floyd has to make a mistake. And if Floyd makes the mistake and, you know, and he's been out of the game for a little bit. He's stepped away. You know, he's in his own little world. If he lets Conor land one or two and he starts landing some solid punches, you know, he could end up giving up probably one of the biggest upsets. You know, and for all I know, they're already setting it up outside for two fights, mm-hmm. two or three little gentlemen saying like, hey, you know, we're going to sell the shit out of this. By the way, I'm going to fucking knock you out. I'm going to make an upset. I'm going to call it right now. I'm just going to put my fix in right now. I'm going to beat you, and then we're going to run it back for a second one. I mean, if you got people like Manny and Pacquiao, who I love them to death, and these two are talking about doing it again just for raising some money. I mean, at this point, it's just about money. These guys want to do it. It's not about that it's advancing the sport or any particular sport. I mean, this is going to do nothing for boxing. It's going to do nothing for MMA.
Right.
It's just purely entertainment. And so for purely entertainment reason, fuck yeah, let's do it.
All right,
let's watch them get in there. And I think now, I mean, especially now, they got Dana and all these other cats talking about the fact that it never really went away. I always kind of thought that, shit, it's probably going
to
happen.
Right. Again, you're right, because in the beginning we were like, this is stupid.
Yeah.
But people have been talking about it for so long, now I think it's going to happen.
Now there's so much talk about it.
I think now it's going to happen.
I mean, especially once major media outlets picked up on it as well.
Let me ask you this. You said nothing's on the line for boxing, nothing's on the line for MMA. But I talked to somebody the other day that brought something up that I hadn't thought about, and they said, dude, if Conor were to beat Floyd, mm-hmm. doesn't that pretty much crush boxing? Doesn't that do away with boxing?
Because one, you're taking a, you know, but this guy, he's a champion. They could always sell it. He's a champion, two different divisions. He's at the top of his game. You know, Floyd stepped away, hasn't fought in like a year. Mm-hmm. By the time this happens, it'll probably be 2 years before Floyd. I mean, there's definitely ways to set it up. And like I said, you know, I'm looking forward to the second fight already. I'm looking forward to the second fight.
Here's the only way I see that Floyd could enter this fight and have no risk if they did it in an octagon. Because here's what you got to figure out. I mean, there's so many question marks, right? Mm-hmm. Like, in fact, Kevin Ioli, good buddy of ours, he wrote a fantastic column, and he addressed some of these things. Like, is it called, and it sounds stupid to us in the MMA game, but is it called McGregor-Mayweather or is it called Mayweather-McGregor? You know what I mean? Like, stuff
well,
like
it's
that.
A boxing fight.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
but there's no champ. I think if it was an MMA fight, I would think you would lead with the MMA.
I agree. But you know what I mean? It's like details like that. There's so many details. Yeah. You know, what weight are the gloves? Da, 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 da. There's so many. But here's what I think. Now, this is crazy.
But that's the thing. I mean, they're talking about a boxing fight. So I think it has to be boxing regulations.
All right, so check this
boxing
out.
Boxing gloves.
Okay, but if they do boxing regulations, does that mean this is a boxing event with a boxing undercard? Or is this a UFC event with a UFC undercard?
I would say stick it on Mayweather. He'd probably want it to be on one of his promotions.
All right, but here's my crazy thought. If Mayweather wants to enter this with no risk on the line, like, because obviously, man, his undefeated record means everything to him, right? What if they did it in a UFC octagon? So it was a UFC card, but the main event was those two fighting in a boxing match in a UFC cage. So it was in an octagon. Yeah. That way, if for some reason Conor gets, and I don't want to say lucky, that's not the right, but if for some reason the unthinkable happens and Conor wins, at least Floyd can say, hey, man, yeah, you beat me, but I wasn't in a boxing ring. I'm a boxer. I wasn't in your circle. You know what I mean? I wasn't in what I'm used to, that sort of thing. Would that build the insurance in?
I don't know. Because I think as for a ring or – you know, whether it's a square-shaped ring or whether it's an octagon, it's still, you know, because I think that they're not going to want to do 4 ounce gloves. He's not going to agree to that.
Oh, hell no.
You know, so I think
I just meant like 10 ounce gloves, 12 ounce gloves.
Yeah, I mean, I think
definitely not doing 4 ounce gloves.
If anything, I think the only way that that, you know, because if they did it like that and they did a UFC promotion, they're going to have to make a number that Mayweather is happy with. And I think they're going to be uncomfortable trying to come up with a number that he wants to.
Right.
Because I don't think they want to cash out $100 million. But if they let it be on one of his promotions where it's all on him to, you know, he's going to get the extra benefits of having the pay-per-view and that sort of deal. And then, you know, a lot of things with the boxing, they have co-promoters. Mm-hmm. I could see it be a Mayweather slash UFC promotion, but be a boxing event where there is an undercard or there's boxers who are getting, you know, practically nothing. And then have it all be about that main thing, whether he's going to get – he can control how much of the pay-per-view points and that sort of deal. I don't see him – wanting to let that part go. Mm-hmm. So I think if it's going to happen, it's going to be a boxing event. And I would say that Mayweather Productions would probably be one half of the thing, and then whether it be the UFC on the other side, using maybe the UFC staff to promote it and PR to do that sort of thing, even though Mayweather's got his people. But you, the way that boxing events are, and they're so haphazard, they're so thrown together, I would say that it probably feels like a UFC event because they'll probably put UFC staffers to help do the PR. But I just don't see Floyd doing it underneath the UFC. I think he wants to be more in control just so he can control, have a better chance of making the money. That way he wants to sign off on how much they're going to get. And I think if it gets to that number, because at this point, you know, Conor wants 50-50 of whatever. Mm-hmm. It's not 50 million. It's not, you know, you know, 25 million or whatever. He wants 50% of whatever it's going to be, you know? So on that, I think there's more than likely that he's going to be willing to go with
the first $1 billion fight. So that's he's basically asked for $500 million.
Yeah, that's crazy. That's bullshit.
But I bet he could ask for $250 million.
$250 million? That's crazy. You could ask for it. You're not going to get
it. No, if this fight happens, I mean, dude, Floyd made what, like $350-400 for the last one?
Right, but I mean, that's one fighter taking 80% of the.
No. Pacquiao, I think, still made like $200 million.
I don't think he made that much.
No. I'm not going to pretend like I'm not.
He made. I heard he made like maybe $100 million or something like that.
Okay.
You know, he made $150 million. Well, which is great.
Pretty strong.
Which is great, but that's Pacquiao. You know, and you're talking about in the boxing thing. Like, I mean, I don't know. I just don't think there's going to be $500 million worth of money getting thrown around for that event for what is going to be one fight. You know.
Crazy. Well, let's say this. All right, we got to get to USC on Fox 23. But let me say this. Think about this.
Yeah, we've talked Conor, a long time about this.
Dude.
But it's crazy. It does seem like it's going to happen.
It's going to happen.
Like I said, I'm looking forward to the second one.
You're such an asshole. All right, let me say this. Conor made his UFC debut in April of 2013. And if you'll remember that, he almost missed his flight because he had to stop by the government office to pick up his welfare check.
Wow.
Think about that. He almost missed his flight to his UFC debut because he needed to go by the government office to get his welfare check.
Was he living with his mom at the time?
Yeah. And now we're talking about him making, conservatively, $250 million for a fight. God damn.
That was awesome. I did like the picture that I don't know if it was New Year pictures or whatever, where they were having a – no, it was his sister's wedding or – was that in a wedding? I want to say it was a family member's wedding or whatever.
Wedding.
Where, like, he saw the picture with, like, his parents. So, I mean, I love that. That's a great story. I mean – if it comes from the fact that, like, he's still living at the house, you know,
in
making
four
so little
years,
money,
bro.
You know, pull welfare or the equivalent of what welfare would be over there, and then to be able to now to probably, I'm sure, his mom and his dad are living high on the hog. So good on that, man. What a story. What a story.
It is amazing. All right, let's talk some UFC on Fox 23. We've talked long enough about this fantasy fight, this no longer fantasy fight that's going to happen. All right.
At least three of them.
All right, overall impression. It was a fun card, right? I mean, it was a fun event. You know, this was not a big event. And as I just said, you know, I'm sharing real information with you guys. We did less traffic at MMA Junkie on this card than we did on Conor. You know what I mean? Like, let's just keep it real. Well, not in total. That's not fair. Not in total we did more. But this was not a high-level card. This was not a high-interest card, I should say. But I'll say I thought it was a fun card, and I will say, man, I love the Fox events, man. That the early time slot, you know, the fact that you have fights starting in the afternoon, they were over by 8 p.m. We were in the mountain time zones there in Denver, you know, so people could still go out and have some drinks afterwards, have maybe a a late dinner afterwards, whatever, man. I love the Fox cards, man. And I don't know. I just, to be honest, like with not a lot of expectations going in, I thought it was a fun night.
Yeah. So it's Mountain, so 1 hour ahead. Okay. I was trying to see. I was slow getting your content out, man.
Wow.
I'm just kidding.
You don't understand time
zone. I'm just kidding. You were in a different time zone. No, I agree. There's something nice about, and it's funny. I lost track of the fact that it was early fight or whatever, and I think Justin or when the first post-fight videos came out, I was like, holy shit. I was like, the fights are on. I actually called over to Agent H. I was like, dude, the fights are on, because it was so early in the day, I didn't even think about it, you know. So, yeah, it's a nice little treat when you're able to get in and get out, and especially on, you know, now that, you know, like college football, that's my favorite thing to watch on Saturdays, you know. So during the day, you know, I'm not – you know, trolling the TV looking for NHL games or NBA, so there's nothing there. So when the fact that the fights came on early in the day, I was like, hell yes, I know what I'm watching now. So
maybe I'm getting old. Well, no, I mean, I'm definitely getting old, but maybe this opinion is based on the fact that I'm getting old. Like, on the East Coast, the pay-per-view start at 10 p.m., right?
Yeah, it's late.
10 p.m.
A lot of pre-gaming, though.
Here they start at 7 p.m. I mean, like, let's say we backed it up 2 hours.
Yeah.
Like, here, us in the Pacific time zone, what if the pay-per-view started at 5 p.m. and on the East Coast they started at 8 p.m.?
Oof.
Doesn't that sound more ridiculous? Or more ridiculous.
Especially because, I mean,
doesn't that sound more realistic? Or are we just getting so old?
I don't know. If you're talking about pay-per-view starting or the main at 5, you're going to lose half of the guys that's still going to be at work. People are going to
stop. Not on Saturday?
Traffic. Well, not on Saturday, but it's just early.
Yeah.
But – I guess if it's on a Saturday, it's not as bad.
It's because I'm old and all I do is worry about fights. That's
no,
right.
I kind of lost track of that. Yeah, it is on Saturday. I mean, it's not bad. I mean, you'd be competing with local news, which isn't a huge draw. But
no, you're right. It's because I'm old. It's because I'm old. All right, let's talk about the main event.
You are.
Valentina Shevchenko, Julian Pena. Listen, watching this fight, I got to admit it, man. I undervalued Shevchenko, man. I really did. She's a complete mixed martial artist. I really thought of her as a striker. The takedowns that she had in the opening round, they were incredible, man. First of all, nobody even expected her to take Juliana Pena down. I mean, I certainly didn't. She scored these takedowns. They were beautiful takedowns. I mean, just perfect timing. I mean, I feel like she's undersized in the division, yet she's still so incredible. And then watching the final armbar, man, watching the way – I mean, it happened literally right in front of us on press row. And it was funny, though, the angle that it was at, I was literally staring right into the face of Juliana Pena, and you could see her grimacing, man. You could see the pain that she was in as she was trying to shift through that armbar. And, man, I just can't say enough about Shevchenko. I think I'm more embarrassed than anything that I haven't been giving her enough credit. And, man, I think her and Nunes, the rematch, might be a great fight. And let's not forget about the first fight where, you know, Shevchenko was gaining steam at the end of that fight. And I don't know, man. To me, this was an eye-opening performance. And I know this wasn't one that people were excited about. And I know that it's not going to be – I mean, this is not a Conor McGregor fight or Ronda Rousey fight or whatever. But to me, this was just one of those eye-opening fights where you're like – holy shit, maybe I haven't been giving this girl enough respect.
That's true. But granted, I'm trying to look back. How long ago was it when she fought Nunes? March. So not that long ago.
It was about a year.
It's been a year.
I was going to say.
It's been a year. It was March 5th, 2016. Granted, I think the March 5th, 2016 Amanda Nunes is not the same Amanda Nunes that we're seeing right
point,
now.
Great point, man, dude. She's carrying herself with more swagger, more.
And just exponentially just seemed to just jump just exponentially from what she was. That would be a fun rematch. She kind of pulled the Holly Holm on Rousey, where it's just like, remember when Rousey tried to take the takedown? And Holly was like, nope, and just shut it down. So to be able to kind of turn it around and just do to Pena what a lot of people thought, that Pena was just going to come in there and just have her way with her. But, you know, shame on you for not giving her credit. You know, I think you could clearly hear me on last episode saying I'm thinking Valentina for sure.
I don't remember going the last episode at all, sir.
It might have somehow got cut in the chopping floor
I don't
or something,
at all.
You know. But – No, I think that's great. I mean, she proved a lot because Juliana is so tough. And I don't know if it also, too, could be part of the fact that Juliana was looking already past Valentina, was so focused on Amanda Nunes, so focused on getting the title, you know, that maybe she didn't take it seriously herself and maybe didn't have the right game plan for it. But you can have all the game plan you want, but if you can't even just do any part of your own game plan, I mean, she just didn't seem to be in it from the get-go. Just nothing seemed to be firing the right way for at least the parts that I saw.
No, I agree. I agree. You're right about that. But, it was just Shevchenko's dominance in there was just crazy to me. And I don't know. I'm thinking about the fight with Nunes, and exactly what you said just strikes a chord with me, that the fact that Nunes, like, has this newfound confidence.
Yeah.
I mean, she does seem different to me. So I don't know if this is the same fight or not the same fight. I mean, I know it'll still be good. I know that sounds weird to say that a person ascending to a title like makes them change, but we've seen it over and over the years. Like, when people reach the highest level, like, all of a sudden, something changes within them, within their dedication, within their ability level, within everything. Like, it just switches. It goes up a little notch. And I do feel like Amanda Nunes is kind of walking around with that right now. So I don't know, to be honest, I mean, I picked Pena going into this fight. I really did. Mm-hmm. I thought Juliana was going to be able to kind of grind against the fence the way she did. I didn't think that she was going to get taken down. I certainly didn't think she was going to be submitted. And now all of a sudden, I feel like I'm kind of reevaluating everything. Shevchenko has kind of changed my mind about all this, and now we got to think about how this rematch is going to look. Shevchenko, she's got a little bit of an accent, but she spoke without a translator. She sat down at the press conference, the new style press conference, just one person at the table, and here's what she had to say.
I was sure about the victory because I had very strong training camp. I trained very hard, and for this fight I was very motivated and very concentrated. I was telling before the fight that I don't care like about one step, and I don't want to think about the future because I'm really focused on this fight. And I knew that I have to win this, and that's why I didn't have choice like, oh, maybe I will lose. No, I didn't have it in my mind. I only think about victory. I think this would help me to do my best.
Can you talk about the game plan? Because of course we knew that she was going to clinch you and try to take you down, but you were the one that initiated the takedowns in the opening round, which I think was surprising. Was that something that you were planning on doing, or was it something you just reacted on the fly?
Like I said before, I'm martial artist. I'm not only striker like people said. I'm complete fighter. I'm MMA fighter. That's why I choose every time tactic depends on my opponent. What tactic will help me?
And talking about being able to submit Pena tonight, it doesn't make it any more satisfying, given what you have been saying all week, that people look at you as just a striker? Does it make the win that much sweeter?
You know, I can say exactly about Pena. She's a good fighter. She's wild. But I'm a master.
And now we know that you're going to get to face Amanda Nunes again. How does it go differently this time around? Does it being a five-round fight change things? Because a lot of people thought it would have the first time. And when would you like to have that fight?
I'm very excited for this fight. I know that it will be a totally different fight with totally different result. And how I said before, Amanda won not because she was stronger than me. It was because maybe I give her some kind, like a little bit reason to take this victory. But I know for sure I was training hard all this time, and every fight make me much stronger and much stronger. And that's why I know I will do my best to take this belt.
So Cole Coffey, Shevchenko, man, she sounds confident. And, dude, when she puts on a performance like that, you have to be impressed. I mean, you have to think, like, you know, she's more well-rounded than we thought. That's for damn sure, right? But, dude, that run that Nunes is on, Nunes is beating legends. You know what I mean? She's beating the best of the best. And again, it sounds weird to just say, well, you're beating these legends, like you're stepping up a notch, but like, man, she's getting it. She's getting it.
Besides that slip up against Ngannou, I mean, you look, it's pretty much a who's who that she's went through. I mean, like we said, you know, you can kind of toss Baszler out of there, even though she's super tough as nails, and then, you know, just didn't really pan out like I thought she would when she came over.
Right.
Durand May, good one. Gaff, another tough one, but not really at the top level. But I think she was still kind of coming up. It was kind of becoming, you know, what we see now. But after Baszler, you know, going through McMahon, who I think is tough as nails.
Tough.
And now is even came back reinvigorated, too. Yep. I think the loss has done really well for her. And then to go through Miesha Tate and do what she did to Miesha Tate, she looks so good. And I think it's hard to top that, but I think she looked even better against Rousey. So it seems, again, that she's on this upward momentum, and whether it's just the confidence, I think, however she's sort of doing her training camps now, whatever is working, whatever she's doing off camp, maybe the fact of just the whole support system, she's fighting so good that, as well as I think Shevchenko's doing right now, I think she's probably distanced herself a little bit, but I wouldn't say that they've both been, you know, on the same particular path. I think they're both have improved incredibly. I don't know if we'll see the same exact fight like we saw last time. I wouldn't be surprised if it went to a decision, but I ultimately think it would probably be the same outcome.
It's hard. I mean, you know, you and I spend a lot of time around these fighters, right? I mean, that's literally all we do. All day, every day, every week, we spend time around these fighters doing interviews, doing videos. Man, there's this thing that's kind of hard to quantify, and I've said it before. Like you can see a person who's trying to make themselves confident,
yeah,
and you can see a person who's walking with that confidence,
yeah.
Amanda's walking with that confidence right now, and I know that sounds maybe, you know, like we're just telling stories or whatever. I mean, yes, it might not be the most technical breakdown of how is her Muay Thai, how is her wrestling, you know, how is she working from range, how is he working on the inside. But I'm telling you, man, this game is so mental.
Yeah.
This game is so mental that when people are carrying that little edge, it means something to me.
Yeah, and I think maybe partially too, I mean, I think a lot of people that they're in the sport, they don't know when the end date is. They don't see the end date, so they constantly go through, and it's a ebb and flow, and it's an emotional thing. I think now when she's set a goal for herself. She wants to have the family. She wants to – so she sees an end date, you know, whether it be two fights, whether it be a few fights. Her main thing is she wants to get these big money fights and get in, get out. I think she's appreciated, and I don't know if she's just using that to fuel her during her camps, whatever she's using to kind of keep her going throughout the fight week. Maybe this realization, this end date that she sees, she's able to keep it all in perspective to keep her pushing forward, to keep her driving, that maybe she never half-assed anything. And that's why she's, you know, improving so much quicker than other people seem to have in the same amount of time. What did you think about, you know, because the whole, now the UFC likes to pull their WWE card every once in a while and bring somebody into the ring afterwards,
right,
during the thing.
That's a good question. All right, that's a good question. That kind of brings me to where I want to go next. So that's perfect. All right, first of all, I'm gonna be honest with you. I hated it. I mean,
feels so forced sometimes.
It is. I mean, it makes sense that Shevchenko and Nunes is the next fight. But first of all, I feel like you're taking away from Shevchenko. Like, that's her moment.
Yeah.
She's celebrating, right?
Yeah.
And now you're bringing in the next champ. And even the next champ, her next
yeah.
fight, she's kind of just enjoying herself and celebrating a little. You know what I mean? Like, why do you have to do it? So, yeah, you know what? To be honest with you, I hated it.
Yeah. And it's funny because Valentina at first was trying to be sort of respectful. And then Amanda came in there and started switching it a little
bit. Yeah, and then they're like
clapping and smiling.
And
you know, but you can't lie about the fact that Valentina, once she's been in there. So it's not like Amanda can come in there and intimidate her. She's like, I've been there. I've taken your punches. You didn't finish me. Mm-hmm. I didn't finish you. You're like, I know what I need to do. And I guarantee that she's done whatever she needs to do. She took that loss to heart, worked on whatever, and I think that's why she did what she did to Juliana Pena. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I don't think it's going to be the same fight. Do I think Amanda's going to win the rematch? My gut tells me yes, but when you watch them talking, there was no fear. And Valentina, I think the clapping, even though that was more to just dispel that
the awkwardness.
Fucking situation that the UFC put her in. You know, I hate the fact.
I hate it.
I wish they would have just at least like, hey, by the way, you know, or maybe now fighters just need to expect it, that stupid shit.
At least
right,
just
it
do
was
a
her
face
moment.
Off. At least just do a face off.
Yeah, to kind of make give words or whatever. And who knows? Amanda, she surprised me, though, because I thought, since Valentina kind of opened up with some actually nice words, you know, just talking about, oh, I'm looking forward to it, good champ, or something along those lines. And then for a man to kind of take it like, oh, well, you know, I did, you know, I'm going to finish you this time or whatever. And it just kind of, you know, it just kind of switched. And I was like, oh, it could have been a cool, unique moment. Now it was just feeling like, oh, it's this forced, awkward thing. And then, you know, seeing her kind of clap and try to laugh it off. And, you know, I'm sure she probably went back like, what the fuck was that?
Yep.
You know, like, you know, I'm sure the UFC doesn't want to tell them or, and they want to keep that raw emotion. But it's like, come on. So now I guess maybe every fighter should just expect if you know that one of your past competitors, somebody you could possibly the next one is there and you win a big fight, just expect that they're going to come into the cage and give some random ass speech. You know, yeah. I don't know. It just struck me as
I didn't like
just
it.
Cheap.
Just, I didn't like it.
Just
I didn't
like a cheap gag.
I didn't like it. But here, all right. So you're right. Like a cheap gag. So what a great way to put it. Here's something that I did like though, and I'm surprised. So here's something that people I saw reacting against that I thought people would like. At the post-fight press conference, it was brought up that maybe Amanda Nunes would move up to 145 pounds and challenge the winner of Holly Holm and Jermaine Durandami for the 145-pound belt, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Dana said, tap the brakes. Tap the brakes. Tap the brakes. And you know what tripped me out is that people tripped out about that. And to be honest with you, I thought it was a good comment. Like, we're
well,
in this
well,
world.
Well, the tap the brakes part, yes. Well, but he followed that up with tap the brakes, defend your belt once.
All right.
She hasn't defended the belt.
He didn't say defend the belt once.
Well, he said
he
she hasn't
say
defended
defend
the
belt.
Belt.
Right. Okay. All right.
Figured people were just being like,
let's
dude,
get into
what
this.
The
let's
fuck?
Get into this. Let's get into this. That to me, exactly what you're saying right now, is why Dana White will never come to a press conference again because of people like you.
Well, you got to watch what he says. He said a stupid phrase.
But you know what he meant. What he meant to say was defend the belt more often.
But that's
defend the belt
very
a little bit
different
more.
Than saying she hasn't defended the belt.
No, he didn't say she hasn't defended the belt. He said defend the belt.
She said she has to defend the belt or she hasn't defended
defend
the belt.
Defend the belt.
I'll have to pull it up.
All right,
again.
We're going
we'll to we'll have to re-listen to it that you just all listened to.
God damn it. We're gonna play it. We're gonna play it after this.
We'll play it in the break or whatever. But regardless, he came off like he sounded like he wasn't paying attention.
I know what you're saying, but you see that's why you never that's why he keeps canceling on us because he knows you're gonna be there.
But also, that's the thing. I mean, if we don't check him on what they say, and you know they say something.
But
you know?
All right. So I was sitting there in the room.
He should have been like, what I meant was. And he didn't stop and say anything like that.
Dude, you used to work for that company.
Yeah.
You know how many things Dana has going on? I'm telling you, I don't think
– I'm sure he's got a whole lot less going on now than he used to.
Wow. So are you – you're frustrating. So are you
– Are you – you think he's listening to this and
no.
he's going to be like, I'm not going to give John that interview
no,
now because he didn't defend me like he best could have.
Of course, he's never listening to this. but no, what I'm saying is, to me, when I was sitting in the room, what I thought was, I mean, he was saying defend the belt a little more often, and I thought people would like that.
You're paraphrasing. You're putting words in there. He didn't actually say that.
Okay, but maybe I am, but at the same time, like, aren't people hating the fact that there's nothing but interim belts right now?
And there's a way he could have phrased that instead of saying, you know, she needs to defend the belt, and they're like, well, you just defend it against the
former
champ.
Well, nobody
said
he's a goddamn trained public speaker.
True.
So what's better? That we quote him word for word and that, like we grill
well,
him
just,
and then we never get to hear from
well,
him
no,
again?
No, he could have said that and then actually just said, what I meant to say was, so he's just spewing
But nobody
stuff
caught
again.
Here's what happened. But cold coffee, here's the problem. If you were right there and you were like, are
I
you?
I would have been like, Dana, she actually defended
but that's
the belt.
What but here's what happens. He speaks. And had somebody at that point gone, Dana, she's already defended her belt. She beat Ronda Rousey. He'd have gone, I'm sorry, I didn't mean defend the belt. What I meant was defend the belt more
so
often.
Why did you do that?
Because I didn't think that it meant anything.
I'm just fucking, you know, I'm trying to find. So what point in the, do you remember what point in the his, this little presser thing? I'm going to do it on the fly. I'm going to look right. You like that?
We're
ad?
Gonna get
this
shut
is
down
the kind of ad. This is the kind of ads that we're getting.
PBS Kids.
PBS Kid is what playing on. All right. So you remember at what point? Oh wait, there you go. Let's defend the title first. Everyone wants to jump around. We got to pump the brakes. That I get. But the fact is, like, let's defend the title first. She hasn't defended the title. That's what people were jumping on.
I get it. But what I thought is, like, Demetrius Johnson has defended his belt, like, 9 times.
Yeah.
I didn't think he meant that she hasn't defended it once.
But when he said – it's one thing if he said, like, she hasn't defended the title.
You're right.
If he would have just said, like, she hasn't defended the title that
much. Had anybody in the room gone, but she just beat Ronda Rousey.
Well, I think they're probably – all right,
well, you know what? Then here's the fucking problem. Here's the fucking problem. Everybody on the fucking internet wants to come and say, oh, why didn't you say this? Why didn't you do this? Yeah. Guess what? Apply for a fucking press pass and go to the press conference and ask the fucking question. And you know what? There were people that were there that were credentialed that left. There were only like 20 credentialed media to begin with, and by the time we were at the press conference, there was like 5 of us. So here's what's – all right, so listen. I hear that, and you know what? I'll even admit, I'm shooting pictures at that time. I'm messaging at the time. You know what?
Well, plus
to me,
have the hindsight to go back as well.
Right. Because
a lot of things happen in the moment that happens, and it goes over your head, and you're like, did he really say that? I'm not quite sure. I'm going to have to go back and listen to what he said after the fact.
Right.
So, I mean, it's one thing. I mean, when you're multitasking, I get it.
But you're calling me out, you asshole.
I didn't call you out.
You did.
I feel
you
like you're feeling guilty.
I feel like you're feeling guilty.
I'm just saying, we were just talking about what Dana said. You know, whatever little perception you think or tax that you feel that you're getting right now, I'm just saying that's why people were giving Dana some grief. Because if you just take him, it wasn't like they took a phrase out of context. He actually made a misstatement. And so people have the hindsight to go back after.
He didn't say defend your title for the first time.
He said she has to. She hasn't defended the title.
He didn't say she hasn't defended.
Let's go back.
Let's defend the title first. You know what I mean? Let her defend her title first. She hasn't defended her title.
Okay, maybe he did say she hasn't defended her title.
She hasn't defended the title. That's the shit that people are fucking saying. But we have the hindsight. I can go back right here.
Sitting in the room.
That's what I'm saying.
Sitting in the room, what I thought is she hasn't defended her title enough to want to go to another division.
You were justifying your head. You were switching your head to what made sense because you're like, oh, he wouldn't say what he just said. But that's what people on the internet, people like myself now, I can hit the back button. We just did it twice. You know, I can hit back and say it. So that's why everybody was like, wait. And so, of course, everybody's like, oh, raise the flag. But in the moment, you know, and he didn't catch it. And you know, and just crazy because he does so many of these things that you figured he maybe would have just said something. He just spoke out of turn. He didn't correct himself. And people jumped on it. And that's why a lot of people were like, what the fuck, Dana? You know, like, I was surprised more people didn't say, you know, like, that shows how far up Ronda's ass you were. You didn't even fucking consider it a title defense or whatever.
For work right now. Do we need to add like a warning or something to this episode?
It's got explicit rating on it. Like our shit's under like the mature or whatever. Not that we're mature, but whatever. But yeah, you brought Pam out for a second. Pam came to the party. Should I get some shoes? I got some like.
No, that was just I wasn't even passive. I was just aggressive. All right. Listen. Well, you know what? You know why it doesn't matter to me? Because you know what? I want to see at 145. I don't want to see Amanda Nunes at 145.
Nah.
I want to see Megan Anderson at 145.
Oh yeah.
Megan's dope.
Dude, I think she is super super tough. She's got the size. I mean,
she's got the size.
She's a big frame.
She's got the attitude.
She ain't no cyborg.
I know.
But cyborg, we might not.
But cyborg's
see down
not
at
available.
145.
Of course, we all want cyborg.
Which sucks, but I think yeah.
But
I
cyborg
don't know.
Disqualified
Cyborg's
herself.
Disqualified herself, which is, you know, I love her fighting style. I love what she does, but it's tough to keep defending somebody when they keep, you know, whether it be the people that surround her and help her make these mistakes, and it's just. tough to keep hoping and hoping and saying it. I mean, I'll never say anything about the fact that she's always been a wonderful professional dealing with us. Yeah. She's always been super, super nice, does great interviews. She's always been very pleasant and nice to me. So as a human being, I absolutely respect her and love her. And even as a fighter, I absolutely respect her. But it's tough to keep pushing and asking and hoping and wishing and wanting something to be there. And they keep doing these things that just makes it impossible to keep them in the same discussion, because you never know if she's ever going to be legal to try to fight these things. But that being said, Megan Anderson is a beast. And, I mean, she's the whole package.
Yep.
I love it. She's all tatted up.
Oh, yeah, right.
She's Australian, right?
Yep.
Got the style. And, I mean, she's got the accent. She's got style. And she's tough. And be great. She would be a wonderful
she's be there. I hope she's going to be there. I hope she's going to be there, Kate. All right, listen. If you like what
so
you're
– so they can bring her in.
Goddamn
to
right.
To do that stupid WWE
no,
style
no, not
shit.
Do that. Not do that. Don't do the face-offs anymore, damn it. It's stupid. If you're going to do a face-off, just do a face-off. Don't do an interview off.
Just point in the cage. Point them outside. And, like, you see your competitors right there. Just have them stand up. Do you have words for them? Granted, you're not going to get the interaction between the
but
two.
But it's better. I think
but that
I think
keeps
the,
it their moment. Keeps
I agree.
It, keeps it your moment. And you wanna sell it up a little bit. Just do that. Have somebody maybe standing outside that if something happens and somebody starts chirping, boom, you have a mic right there that you can give it to them and they could do it. But don't take that moment away from that person, because now you just ruined her moment. She just submitted the number one contender, higher ranked girl, the girl that everybody was saying this is the person that's going to beat Nunes or have a chance, and then you ruined her moment by making this little WWE thing. But I don't know, maybe we're the minority. Maybe most people are like, that was my favorite part of the fight was the post fight.
Nobody felt that way.
I don't think I think that's the true as well, but you never know.
They can hit us up on Twitter at MMA Junkie John, at Ken S. Hathaway, at The Cold Coffee, THE. But they won't.
Say,
Did you like that?
Because I think they didn't.
They know.
All right,
let me say something. If, by the way, you're listening and you like this, Jesus Christ, I hope you like this.
We've been a lot of anger this week.
We had some frustration. It's because I'm on no sleep, and I came over here and I was ready to record, and you made me wait hours.
Because of why?
Because you were cooking steak dinner.
Oh my goodness! And then H&H gave you what the whole time?
Shots
and beer
and beer.
Shit is tough.
I was ready.
Shit is tough.
I should have been home. But all right, listen. But if, by the way, through all that anger, you like what you're hearing, what you should do is you should go on iTunes.
Oh shit! I forgot to hit record.
You should give us 5 stars.
Gotcha.
You son of a.
Just I want to see if you that I want to see if it would come
should,
back
you
out.
You should give us the stars. You should rate us. You should review us. You could be like Gorilla Candy.
Ooh,
who's my new favorite person?
That sounds a great.
Check
name.
This out. Love the MMA Roadshow. Truly a genuine show for hardcore MMA fans. John Morgan and Cole Covey have great chemistry. Debatable.
Fuck you.
Debatable.
I hate you.
They both share great insight before the fights with interviews, fight card information, and prediction. I even like the. And a half episodes better, where they talk about the fights after the event. Keep enjoying the frosty beverages and doing the best MMA podcast.
Aw.
That's what's
Gorilla
up.
Candy.
Gorilla Candy.
I like that.
All
that
right,
sounds like that would be like a really tasty candy.
It depends what part of the gorilla it is.
Just the hairy. Like some. It had to have peanuts in it, right?
Peanuts. Oh,
not penis, peanuts. Maybe like it'd be like maybe a banana and like nuts. Oh, baby.
Why is
this? Laptop.
Why is this quickly turning into a New Orleans slash Glasgow type event?
Was Glasgow bad?
Dude.
Was Glasgow bad? Did we get like really?
No,
like
you
shitty?
Weren't in Glasgow.
Oh, okay. I was like, I don't remember that. I was like, maybe it was bad.
Glasgow was weird.
Oh wait, I remember.
Glasgow
you guys
was
about
when
Glasgow.
We ended up having an impromptu house party.
Yeah,
with people that I had
that
never met.
Some random guys slept in the window.
And they were
so.
Really nice guys. Really nice guys.
Yeah, I feel like I missed out on that one.
You did miss out on it. Should we do this shot while we're recording?
We gotta wait for Agent H to get back.
All right. By the way, while we're waiting for Agent H, let me just say. You probably didn't see this, but Diego Brandão picked up an awesome victory this weekend at EFN 58. He won the fight via helicopter armbar, where you basically from the guard push somebody up. They they turn and you drop them in the armbar position, which is crazy because, ironically, Saturday morning, right before the fights, I was talking to Ed Soros. Me and Ed Soros just kind of ran into each other at the hotel, and we were talking to each other. And the submission of the year from the RFA, one of the candidates at the World MMA Awards, is Thiago Moises versus David Castillo at RFA 35, was a helicopter armbar. And we were literally talking to each other, and he was like, dude, I think that should be the submission of the year because you never see that shit.
Yeah.
You never see that shit. And it's true. You never see that shit. It's like stuff that you get taught in a jiu-jitsu class that never happens.
Right.
And then Diego Brandão did it, you know, the same day, which is incredible. Brandão, man, I'll be honest. I'm a Diego Brandão fan. He had problems. He has some issues. He's definitely crazy. He had some substance issues as well, but – I tell you what, man, he's a very loving guy. We told the story before on the press conference – or on the press conference. I don't know why I'm talking about the press conference. On the show about his – you know, on his arms. He has his mom's name on one forearm and his dad's name on the other arm, which, I mean, I think it's pretty cool. And I just think he's one of the nicest guys out there. If you follow, like, his social media feeds, like, it's all about positivity and it's all about, like, beautiful things. Yet at the same time – one of the memories I always have of him is fuck it, I can't remember what UFC it was. Him and Dustin Poirier when they fought, and there was a press conference, and in the post fight press conference afterwards, I remember asking Dustin Poirier, what was he saying to you? Because I think they were having like some issues like on stage at the weigh-ins or maybe backstage, and Dustin Poirier was like, he said he's gonna stab me in my neck. I was like, what? He says, and it was funny because like the microphone got passed right away, and I still had eye contact with Dustin Poirier. So like he, you know, he just kind of dropped that out there, and then we like moved on. And I'm like, he, you know, but I still had eye contact with him. I'm like, he really said that? Like just giving him that? And like Dustin's like, yeah, man, he really said. I'm like, fucking said he's gonna stab you in your neck. And then like who says that? But yeah, here's the guy who has love for his mom. And left for his dad and puts it on his arm. And if you follow him on social media, it's all like, God bless the day. You know, we're so like, I love his positivity, man. I love his positivity. So Diego Brandão picked up an amazing win. All right. So are we just going to do this real quick?
Yeah, we can do this.
All right.
We'll do this?
Yes. This is definitely turning into a very New Orleans, Glasgow type broadcast. That's right.
Cocktails. Ooh. Yeah, that's what is it that we're drinking again?
Fire Jack. All right. Jorge Masvidal versus Donald Cerrone. Man, this was a great fight. All the fight that we expected to be until Masvidal landed that big overhand right, and it was over at that point. Cool coffee, man. Cerrone showed heart, dude. I mean, no surprise. I picked Donald Cerrone going into this fight. I mean, no question, he's one of my favorite guys out there, dude. I just love his attitude, I love his style. But, man, this fight was probably over at the end of the first round. And it reminded me a hell of a lot of Michael Bisping versus Anderson Silva, you know, the end of round three there where it looked like it was a knockout. It wasn't ruled a knockout. Yeah. Ironically, it was actually Herb Dean, the referee. The other ironic part about it was literally on the exact same exact same part of the cage, because like in London when it was Michael Bisping and Anderson Silva, it was on the opposite side of press row. This was also on the opposite side of press row. It was crazy, man. It was crazy, and man,
Did you hear it the same? Because watching on the fight pass, it was the bell came a decent bit after Herb went in there. So I don't know how it played out, how it looked to you. I mean, I completely forgot about that until you just mentioned that. Because it looked like it came after it. I don't know if that's all right, just a sound transmission. I'm seeing the whatever, but usually the shit's pretty spot on and pretty close when it comes to the transmission.
I couldn't hear it live, and but it was just so reminiscent of that fight where I do think, you know, I've gone back and watched it back since. And I think Herb Dean is one of the best officials in the game. It's crazy because you're at UFC events all the time just like I am. And Herb Dean gets some of the biggest cheers of the night. It's crazy. Like, Herb Dean gets announced, you know, sure. They'll be like, fighter A, you know, Bruce Buffer going to his thing, fighter A, fighter B,
yep,
referee this, and he gets the biggest cheer, right? I mean, it's crazy.
Well, I mean, another person, but I think Yamasaki does it as well. Yeah. People absolutely hate Yamasaki, wow, but he gets a lot of people to cheer for him, too. So it's, I don't know, but I would think Herb gets a lot more cheers than Yamasaki. But.
And I think Herb made a mistake here. And, yeah, I think he made a mistake here. And in real time, it was hard to figure out because I thought, to be honest with you, that he was rushing in right as it happened. And I think he was giving Donald Cerrone kind of the leash that he needs to get because Donald Cerrone is he's a beast, dude. There's no question about, you know, his mindset and who he is as a fighter. But at the end of the day, I think he did make a mistake, and I think that's fine. I have no problem with people telling me I made a mistake. Yeah. I'm sure people will tell you made a mistake. I am not insulting Herb Dean as a referee. I think he's an incredible referee. I think he does an incredible job. I just think at this moment he made a mistake, and that shit happens. And, well, listen, I mean, don't let us talk about it. I asked Dana White, and I also asked Jorge Masvidal what they thought about it. And to be honest with you, sounds like they thought the same way.
Dana, can you give your thoughts on Cowboy and Masvidal? Because it happened right in front of you, the end of the first round.
I picked up the phone and I called production and said, was that correct? Was that a correct was it the end of the was it the end of the round? It wasn't. It wasn't the end of the round. He stopped it early. But not to defend Herb Dean. It was so loud in that arena. I didn't hear it either. Maybe you guys heard it. You're sitting closer to it, but I didn't hear it.
So you're okay with it continuing then?
It is what it is. Mistakes are going to happen, and you know, it's one of those. Listen, I hate when Cowboy does this. You know, he's got four wins at welterweight, and he wants to fight back-to-back like this. But that's who this kid is. That's what he wants to do. It is what it is. Now, Masvidal never pulls the trigger, this kid. You know, incredibly super talented. If he fought all the time like he fights tonight, he'll be a world champion.
Zabadoo! What's up, everybody? Much like our commander-in-chief, I won't be addressing fake media. So if I don't call on you, it's because it's fake media. No, because you're racist. The Jake Ellenberger comment. Next. Now, you were MMA junkie, so what's up, man? Go for it.
Jorge, obviously an incredible performance from you tonight. Dana was actually here earlier, and he said that the thing that he impressed him the most tonight was that you really pulled the trigger, where sometimes you hesitate. Did it feel different tonight, and do you feel that was the key?
Nah, I'm a fighter, you know. Sometimes I like to play with my food. I like to beat guys up. I like to torture guys. Sometimes I don't pull the trigger. Sometimes I drop dudes, and I smile at them after I drop them. I do what I want, and then does nobody tell me what to do or how to do it, you know. I felt like knocking him out because I wasn't going to decision. That's why I pulled the trigger every chance I got because I wasn't going to go to decision. That was my plan. Sometimes in the past, I've been on cruise control kicking a guy's ass so much that I'm like, I don't need to pull the trigger. I'm just outskilling him everywhere. But I could pull the trigger when it needs to be pulled.
And we thought maybe you finished the fight at the end of the first round. Can you talk about kind of what you saw there? Did you think the fight was over? Were you okay with it continuing? What were your thoughts?
What was weird to me was when Herb pulled me, it's only a second, so you think, oh, man, it's only a second. But that second, he pulls me off, and then the bell rings. You could see it on the replay. So that second lands me another two punches, you know. Hats off to Cabo for even getting up because I looked right into his soul when he got up, and he wasn't there. And when he came out, he wasn't there, so he's a warrior.
You guys had some words back and forth, but it looked like you guys talked in the cage. Can you tell what was said between you two?
I just told him he's a tough dude and whatever, you know.
And last for me, I know you want a big fight next. Is there something specific? I mean, you got Damian Maia out there. He's been looking for like a number one contender fight. I think I saw a lot of people online saying Nick Diaz would be a fun fight if he's ready to get back in there. Is there something that you've got your eyes on?
The bigger the fight, the better. The more I train, the more I prepare, you know. My coaches know when it's a big fight, I'm going to be at the gym. If they give me some pretender, another actor, I don't know, man. I might not take it. That's why I told Dana, if you want to fight, you want me to fight, take me up on this bet. $200,000, you can't find nobody in the welterweight division that could beat me. Nobody.
All right, by the way, we dropped a subtle little audio transition in there in case I'm not sure if you picked up on that. In the moment that it went from Dana White to Jorge Masvidal, I called a little bit of a high-level production there. And I dropped that in. I asked Cole Coffey to do it. I shouldn't say I did it myself because I'm not actually physically capable of doing that because I suck at all the technical aspect of it. But hopefully you picked up on that subtle little audio transition.
Smooga.
Wow, you actually did that live.
That sounded like a car.
You actually did that live. All right. By the way, we had mentioned Anderson Silva in that last little broadcast, little segment, I should say. Can we just say that him saying that he wants to fight Conor McGregor is stupid? Anderson Silva, at 185 pounds, saying he wants to fight the former 145-pound champion, the current 155-pound champion. I'm sorry.
Well,
God damn it. I love you, Anderson Silva.
Yeah.
That's just stupid.
It is. But, I mean, everybody's going to ask for the big money fights. But the fact that he recently just saw Conor go up and fight at 170, knows that he weighs more than 170 typically when he's walking around. So the fact that he's like, I think he can make 175, 178, or whatever it was. He's not going to try to go up even higher just so he can fight a bigger guy like Anderson.
You have stood next to Anderson Silva, and you have stood next to Conor McGregor.
Yeah, it's two totally different things.
But that's two different human beings.
I mean, Conor, yeah, he's big when it comes to the weight size when he fights at the 145, 155. And let's be real, like Nate was the bigger man. Nate is dwarfed by Anderson.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
But, you know, it's not the same Anderson that we've seen. And we know that Anderson, when he signed that last big contract, he wants money. He wants money. He's got a big entourage that he takes around with him.
Yes, he does.
As much as he says he wants to challenge himself because of the skills, maybe it is. Maybe there is a semblance of that.
Everything I've heard is that he needs money. He actually.
But that's what I hear a lot, too. I hear he's got, like, a ton of houses. You know, in Brazil, and he's not getting all the advertising dollars that he used to. I remember when he'd go there before for events, I'd see him on bus stops. I'd see him, like, his face all over the place. And I don't know if that still happens. My thinking is that no, after he wasn't the champ, you know, I think a lot of that stuff dropped away. I think the Brazilian culture, you know, while you're a champion, they love you and embrace you. And then when you're not, they're like, sorry, we're going to move on to the next big thing, you know. But, yeah, it's just bizarre. I don't hate it, but it's just so bizarre and out of there. And if it wasn't Conor just, you know, going around doing all these different weight classes and kind of doing it, and it'd be one thing if it was DJ who physically probably could get himself big enough to weigh that much. He'd never be of fighting quality. Mm-hmm. Conor can get up to that weight. He can fight. But it wouldn't be smart for him because it'd be heavier than he ever normally is when it comes to fighting and trying to do that sort of thing. And it's just bizarre.
It's just silly.
But
all right,
you never know.
Back to UFC on Fox 23. Francis Ngannou defeated Andrei Arlovski first round TKO.
Talking about big guys,
dude. All right, let me just round out the main card too. Jason Knight defeated Alex Caceres. Be a second round submission.
That was awesome.
Let me just say this. By the way, if you are listeners of the MMA Roadshow, you know, bro, we've been trying to tell you, Francis Ngannou, Jason Knight, tune in. We've been trying to tell you. We've been doing the best we could.
We told them.
We pick our guys. We're like, that's somebody you need to watch.
Yeah.
And we did our best. We did our best. Now they're on Fox doing big things. I will say this. Man, Francis Ngannou's a beast. I think we've phrased that enough times. Andrei Arlovski hated to see him lose again, man. Andrei Arlovski, one of the nicest guys that you'll ever see in the sport. I'm not sure if I should even say this or not, but if you watched the countdown show, you saw that his dog, his longtime pit bull Maximus, had some surgery and had some issues. I actually heard that his dog passed. Couple weeks ago.
Sucks. I know he loved that dog.
Oh, my God.
I mean, like,
dude.
That dog followed him everywhere.
His best friend. I mean, that's literally, like, his effing best friend, dude. Like, literally his best friend.
That sucks. I mean, that doesn't
doesn't change the fact that Ngannou's a beast.
Yeah, it doesn't stop you from not moving your head.
He looked good, dude. Arlovski was moving in. He was moving out. He was trying to use the speed. But I'm not going to lie to you.
That shot grazed over the top of his head.
And that hurt him.
And it was enough. Granted, the hook that followed with it, he was done. But that shot that – because I remember Agent H was like, did that really hurt or whatever? She's like, why did he fall? I'm like, That one is the power, because it didn't quite catch him on the temple, but it hit him, looked like it was more flush on the top of the head, like it just grazed up, but there was enough force behind it that I think knocked his equilibrium all off, and then when he followed up with that, then it was just donezo. That's just the power. This guy is he's a guy that he could play offensive line, he could play defensive line on an NFL team and would just beast on some dudes.
Well, here's what's crazy is that, like, I mean, I think Ngannou is only like an inch taller than Arlovski and only weighed at the official weigh-ins like 8 pounds more.
Mm-hmm.
But they look like they're in different weight classes.
Yeah.
It's just something about the way they're built. It's crazy. And, yeah, man, Ngannou's he's a beast. And now they're saying, I mean, they want the top. They want the best of the best. And you know what? Dude, I think they're ready for it. And, you know, man, it's funny because – you know, we started seeing Francis come up around the same time we started seeing Derek Lewis come up,
yeah.
The Black Beast. And I still love the Black Beast. Dude, his social media is the best. But I'll tell you what, man, Ngannou has – I mean, based on their most recent performances, Ngannou is the higher-ranked guy right now.
Well, he's stolen momentum.
Exactly.
He's stolen And that was the thing. We talked a while back. We were like, oh, you know, this is a battle that eventually is going to happen. But it was also one we didn't want to happen because we didn't want to see either one of the guys sort of lose that momentum and lose the thunder. And we didn't want either one of them to knock themselves out of contention mm-hmm. when it goes up. I mean, this is the new cream of the crop, mm-hmm. the new classmates that are coming in here and just destroying people. And Derek, yeah, his last performance. And he was even – that's why what I love about Derek is the fact that he was so hard on himself about that past performance. Didn't want to call out anybody. Was just like, you know, like, I'm not even happy with this last thing. And I love that about him. I don't want to see those two face right now.
I don't either.
I don't want to see either one lose. But also, after Francis's last performance, you know, yeah, I would think I would give him the edge because mm-hmm. lately Derek's been trying to throw more of these leg kicks, which have been, you know, causing him a problem. He's gotten away of sort of just getting in there striking. I don't know if he's, you know, I love the fact because he's a mixed martial artist. He wants to do all the different things. And I think, you know, when going there and doing some of the other things, you're going in there thinking like, oh, I'm going to be a well-rounded. As this fight goes on, I want to make sure I work the legs and I work the head. Whereas Francis is like, I'm just going to hold off until I get a little bit closer to you. Then I'm going to hit you with this right hand, and then I'm going to follow with the left, and then you're done. You know, there's no finesse. There's no real game plan. He's not like, you know, I got to make sure I do this. He's just doing what works, and he's cutting all the bullshit. And I think what's wonderful about that, and I'd hate to see him against Derek right now because I'd be afraid that Derek would want to try to do some of these other things, try to throw a little leg kick to eventually throw, you know, set up a shot. Whereas Francis is like, I'm just going to get in there. I'm gonna grab that leg, and then I'm going to take a shot. And I don't want to see that right now.
I
want to see Derek keep rising up because he's another big favorite of ours, and I think he's another beast. And I'd love to see those guys build up, keep getting better, and then eventually one of them's going to get the title,
and then have
that be a title fight
when they
fight.
Well, and we'll get to I'm bummed. I will say this. We were supposed to get to see the Beast in Brooklyn. I thought the MMA Roadshow was going to get to have a little fun with the Beast. That's not going to happen. He's now going to be in Halifax, Nova Scotia. So we'll figure out what we can do with that. But in the meantime, we did get to ask a chance a few questions with Francis Ngannou. Believe it or not, nobody else asked questions at the press conference of Francis Ngannou. It was literally just me. This is not an edit. This is literally just me talking to Francis Ngannou. And then also getting Dana White's thoughts as well.
Quickly, obviously you gave him $50,000, so you must have been impressed with Francis Ngannou. But it sounds like you're high on him. You think he can be a future champion. How fast do you think he can get there? Because, I mean, he is still so young in his career.
I know. He is young in his career. It's one of those tough decisions when you have a guy that's this talented and this just freakish. You know what I mean? The guy's a monster, and I'm really high on him. I think he's the future. The question is, I don't know if we've ever had a heavyweight that's been as big as this guy is. A heavyweight champion, you know what I mean? A heavyweight champion who is as physically imposing and scary as this guy is. And I love his story. He's got a great story. I think he's the future. So we'll see what happens.
Kabooga!
Francis, Obviously, another very impressive victory for you tonight against a former champion on Fox. Big opportunity. Just talk about how you felt in there through the whole time. Were there any nerves? Did you feel uncomfortable? What was your emotions like through the fight?
During the fight, I don't know why, but I think now I start to have the experience in UFC because I'm very, 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 very confident and very relaxed. And then I'm able to understand what my team tell me to do always. And then this time is too better than the beginning.
When you landed the big uppercut, did you know that the fight was over at that point?
No. For the uppercut, I didn't know that before, but I just, doing that for the training camp a lot of time. So I'm a striker. I know that he too is a striker, and he strike very, very, he has very aggressive.
Yes,
he's aggressive, and to stop it, uppercut can stop someone who is very aggressive.
And afterwards, we read your quote that you said Alistair Overeem or Junior Dos Santos might be good fights for you next. Why are those two fights that you would like?
I would like even, I think that, I'm talking about Junior Dos Santos and Alistair Overeem, but I just talk about them because I think that Ken Velasquez is injury. If he's on the game, I'm ready for him. He's the next one who I would like to fight.
And lastly for me, I know you're standing at the back of the room. You hear Dana talking about how impressed he is with you, that he believes you could be a future UFC champion. How do you feel when you hear the boss making those type of comments?
He made me happy. He made me confident, like as everyone else, you know. Since when I started this sport just 3 years and a half ago, and then always when I continue, I grow, there are a lot of people behind of me who believe me and who push me, who make me trust of me, because for the beginning, it's not something who interested me. And then today, because of that people who push me up, I believe and I trust for this sport. Since when I have my sign on UFC, and then people continue to support me to stay behind of me, and he pushed me up. He make me be strong.
All right, Francis Ngannou, an MMA Roadshow guy. We're going to see how he does moving forward. Another MMA Roadshow guy, as we said just before, Jason Knight, picked up a huge win over Alex Caceres. Tough to see Alex Caceres lose as well. I love that. I love that kid, man. He's so fun to talk to. But Jason Knight, I love this guy, man, and it was crazy because when he was walking in the cage, man, you could tell he was fighting back tears, man, and I didn't even know that or understand about it. And then we found out later that his dad's birthday was the next day. His dad is passed on, and I just, man, I gotta say, man, I love this kid. Maybe it's just the fact that I'm a Southerner. I'm definitely not a Mississippi kid like him, but I love the accent. But I love the way he fights, man. That dude just comes to fight and makes no bullshit about it. And as he said, he wants to fight Duho Choi. Amazing. You know, I'm down for that. I just love watching that kid fight.
Yeah, he is something. And it's funny because he's got this just not naiveness. He's just so fresh. He's so new to the game. I love the whole backwards, just I come as I am sort of thing to him. There's no showboating. There's no, you know, sort of airs to him. He just, you take me as I am. You know, you like me or you don't. You know, there's something very, very refreshing about it. And, dude, he just fucking balls, man. I actually thought Jason was going to maybe be in there a little too overconfident. And I thought Alex was going to take it. And, boy, he just handled him. I mean, he proved such a well-roundedness in that fight. Whereas Alex just sort of just has a way when he gets to the ground, those long legs of his, and he's just squirmy. And Jason just looked better than him. I'm not sure when it comes to whether he's a black belt or whatever. And, you know, I'm pretty sure Alex is a black belt. Jason, I'm not quite sure. Maybe I'm wrong in both counts. But just the way that he was
able to... Hey, man, I got a brown belt. Why are you worrying about that?
Jason, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, brother. I'm sorry, brother, man.
I don't wait till I have black belt, man.
I got brown belts. I got a green belt,
I got brown
I'm sure.
belts. I got black belts. I got camo belts. What you need, man?
But no, he's a lot of fun. And, yeah, I mean, shit.
Shit, man.
I didn't realize I was here with Jason. Jason, when the fuck you come in here?
Oh, man. He just went away. Hey, what you think about that fight with Sam Alvey and Nate Marquardt, man? That wasn't that good, man. I'll tell you what, man. They went to try to punch him, man. They didn't do so good, man.
Jason, it wasn't what I expected.
No, it wasn't what I expected. How about that Rafael? He would probably say more like that. How about that Rafael Sungkao?
Sungkao.
And that Aljamain's. Oh, well, there's no way to make fun of that name. All right, no, listen. Aljamain Sterling. I did think Rafael Sungkao won his fight. It was a split decision. It's crazy because Rafael's a beast, and I think Aljamain is a beast too. But as great as he looked, he was moving well. He was showing some things, but he wasn't doing the right things.
Yeah.
He wasn't doing the right things. To me, Aljamain is still a top prospect, but he's going to drop a couple of notches down the post because he just wasn't executing. And it was tough to watch because I think Aljamain is incredibly athletic. I think he's incredibly talented. But I just don't think he was doing the right things.
Yeah, both of them just weren't pulling the trigger. I think there was a lot of respect going on. And what's weird, I don't know if you went back and watched, you know, you saw it there, and, you know, I had the luxury of watching replays. Mm-hmm. And they were talking about the one punch that Sungkao threw, and it looked like it actually dropped Aljamain, but it actually hit the shoulder. Aljamain threw one of his shots, but he dropped down to his knee. And what they were sort of commenting is that it looked like that he got dropped by the shot, and they were wondering if the judges gave Sungkao credit for dropping
him. It's funny because I didn't watch the broadcast. I did. Yeah. I thought he got dropped by that.
Yeah, so he actually hit the shoulder, and when
I remember that
when
shot.
Aljamain throws back, kind of throws off balance, drops down to a knee, lofts his balance. And I wonder if that's even enough that a judge sees that, and he's like, oh, okay. He got dropped, so I'm going to give that round to him. I mean, Aljamain had more kicks in the fight. Rafael had more strikes in the fight, you know, and more punches in the fight. Both to me, I kind of was leaning toward the fact that Aljamain was controlling the octagon. He was pushing the pace more. Mm-hmm. I use that in my judging it that was what was going to give him the fight. And I had the luxury of watching the replay in here and say, oh, okay, he didn't get dropped. He actually dropped. He lost his balance.
Right.
So that takes that off the
that's
books.
True.
And I think that's ultimately why that fight maybe went.
That's interesting. It was a close fight.
Way. It was a close fight.
It was a close fight. I'll tell you what, a great fight. A
People
great
were not happy about
fight.
That one.
Li Jingliang beating Bobby Nash. I'll tell you what, Li Jingliang, I'm a fan of this guy, and I get it. Most of you probably don't know who he is. I've had a chance to see him multiple times, you know, coming from China. The Ultimate Fighter, China, those sort of things. I think this dude is so much fun to watch. I'm not saying he'll necessarily be a UFC champion.
Yeah.
But he is a dude you need to watch. Put him on your list. If you see Li Jingliang on the fight card.
I butcher his name. I had no idea that's how you properly say it.
How the hell do you say it?
How do we say
man,
last night? We were like,
that's
we
a
like
Li
Jingliang. I think we were like Jingliang.
All right, well. Li Jingliang is well. Listen, I'm not saying that's the right way to say it. That's just the way.
That's
I'm
just
saying
the way
it.
You say it.
Yeah, yeah. We'll get
Let's
it.
Call up Anik.
I'll get
Let's
his
call
actually.
Anik. Anik will tell us how.
Well, no, we can get the actual Chinese saying, but I'm just saying that kid is fun to watch. Dude,
we
this fight was
Chinese
amazing.
We speak right now. We're talking English.
That's true. I'm telling you what, you need to watch this kid. Put him on your list. He is fun to watch. Jordan Johnson beat up Luis Henrique de Silva. He really did beat him up. Eric Spicely. Again, another incredible win, impressive win. I think people knew this was possible. I mean, Alessio Di Circo, the Italian, he's more of a striker. But Eric Spicely, I guess, basically at the end went back and called me and you essentially out for.
No, he just called you out.
Well, but he meant essentially me and you because we didn't recognize him at the.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, but thankfully he doesn't know my name or he probably would have. which is unfortunate because it happened, you know, and it sucks that we didn't get it on the video or whatever. But, yeah, he was like, you know, where's Morgan at? You know, screw him because we were sitting at a churrascaria in Brazil. Imagine that, us at Brazilian steakhouses. We love our meat, and we like the steak, too. And he had been calling your name over and over. And granted, I was there. I don't remember him calling it out as well. So, you know, I'm definitely to blame as well. But since the fact that you didn't pay attention to him or we didn't hear, he went back there and was using some choice words for you, you know, just playfully rubbing. I mean, granted, he didn't go the route like George did and called you a racist on a press conference, you know, but, you know, that's the fun thing about these fighters. I mean, like, as badass and as tough as they are, you know, and all this stuff, that's when I tell people about one of the funnest parts about the job is having those other moments and being able to come back and kid with these guys and have that fun. It makes the long days, you know, a lot better. So that was a nice moment that, granted, I wasn't there, but just even watching, I felt the love of the situation.
Eric
so
Spicy,
cool.
Eric Spicy, give him some love. He's the MMA Roadshow friendly.
Yeah, and he was busting Morgan's balls.
Exactly, so that's what's up. Alessandro Pantoja picked up a split decision win over Eric Shelton. That was a great fight, and both those guys are people that you need to pay attention to, man. Up and coming flyweights, no doubt about that. And start of the night, it was Jason Gonzalez with a slick little darce choke. If you didn't check that out, over JC Cottrell. JC was winning the fight, and then Jason Gonzalez just picked up a scramble and picked up a submission win. Dude, I'm telling you right now, if you missed anything, because you probably watched the main card, if you missed everything else, go back and watch that Lee Jinglang fight versus Bobby Nash. That was fucking fun, dude.
Or Lee Jinglang.
Whatever, dude. Be Spanish.
He's Spanish.
Be Spanish. Yeah, it was awesome. Go back and watch that fight. All right, listen, dude, it's late. I've barely been asleep yet. Cold coffee plied me with steak and beverages, and it's made me be up way late. I wanted to be home and in bed at this time. He made me wait up hours and hours and hours just to do this thing. So hopefully we didn't bore you too much. And sorry that we're a little late, but I thought it'd be better with the crew back together than just me by myself. And real quickly, a lot of people hit me up the other night, and it was actually kind of cool. During the press conference, the microphone was open during the press conference, and we were kind of talking between the interviews about the fact that, you know, this whole Trump stuff, not that we're going to get political, and we're not going to get political, because I'm not political. To be honest with you, I'm stupid outside of anything other than mixed martial arts. Like, literally, that's my life. So I will not pretend that I know all the things that are going on in this world. But I will know this, that it does scare me a little bit with all the stuff that's happening with people coming in and out of our country. My wife and my son are in Mexico right now, and they both are U.S. citizens, but it still scares me a little bit.
They're dual citizens.
They are dual citizens, but it scared me a little bit because all the stuff that was going on during the fight the other night. But it's funny because there was an open microphone during the press conference, and some people were hitting me up, and I was actually getting texts and WhatsApp and other things for people that were saying, like, hey, bro, we can hear you, we can hear you. But I was literally just talking with people around me, like, about my family situation. Like, man, I hope they can get back in. I don't think it'll be an issue, but, you know, maybe it will be an issue because, dude, it is scary to me, man. This shit is scary to me. I'm not going to lie. It's scary to me, and I'm not going to say what's right and what's wrong because I'm not going to even pretend like I'm smart enough to know what's right or what's wrong. But let me just tell you, as a guy who has a wife and a son who are citizens of this country and that are in another country, I'm a little bit afraid that they won't be able to come back. And if that shit happens, it's not right. It's just not right. And again, I won't try to tell anybody what their opinion should be and what it shouldn't be, but I'm just telling you, we always keep it real on the show. I mean, it's just me and cold coffee talking about shit we really feel, and I'll be honest with you, man. I've been married to my wife for almost a decade, and my son was born in the United States. And if neither one of them if they have issues coming back, I'm sorry, but I think that's fucked up. So hopefully that doesn't affect them, and I'm just praying that everything's good. In the meantime, thanks for listening.